And now, please welcome UnidosUS Vice President for Programs, Mauricio Garcia.
Buenos dias. ¿Cómo están? This morning, we gather to address another very pressing issue, the growing challenges confronting our collective efforts to foster a culture of innovation and belonging. Diversity, equity, and inclusion, or as many of us know it as DEI, aren't just buzzwords. They're not just terms that we throw around. They're not marketing. They are fundamental pillars for any institution, whether government, corporate, or nonprofit, to create a fair, inclusive, progressive, and participatory environment. Yet, there are so many obstacles to this right now. We are facing resistance from a variety of groups aiming to dismantle policies and practices designed specifically to rectify historical and systemic injustices affecting not only Latinos, but all communities of color. We've seen the dismantling, most prominently through the Supreme Court's decision to restrict race-conscious admissions. We've also seen it through a slew of lawsuits against minority-owned businesses with equity initiatives, and we've seen it through over 20 state governments, including most prominently Texas and Florida, who are weighing or passing laws to restrict DEI efforts. As advocates, we stand firm in our commitment on these issues. UnidosUS, along with our allies, all of you, will not back down in our pursuit of justice and equity for all. But before we dive into this really meaty issue, I want to be able to present our featured speaker, who knows a bit about this work. She's committed a lot of her time in this area. Janis Bowdler serves as a counselor for racial equity at the U.S. Department of Treasury. She is a fellow Midwesterner. She hails from Ohio, and I'm from Michigan, whose career has encompassed local service, national advocacy, international philanthropy. She sounds like a secret agent. Janis is a proud Latina who draws on her lived experience and two decades of collaboration with the Latino, Black, and AAPI communities in her dedication to dismantle the structural and institutional racism, perpetuating the widening racial wealth gap. And for many of you who know her, she is also an UNIDOS alum. So with that, please join me in welcoming the Counsel for Racial Equity at the U.S. Department of Treasury, Janis Bowdler.
Good morning. Oh, I know you had a warm up already. Come on. Good morning. Like you've had some coffee. Thank you. Every time I get to come here, it's like coming home. And so I know there are many friends in the audience. I'm not going to be able to see all of you and hug all of you, but please know that it gives me so much joy to be back here with my family to see you. I see people. It gives me so much joy, and I really appreciate my UNIDOS family always inviting me back. I was here 2 years ago when I was still relatively new in my role, and at that time, I shared with you our vision, a vision for an economy where, regardless of your zip code, regardless of your place of birth, the language you speak, the makeup of your family, or who you call family, that the economy was going to work for you, that we were going to bring down some of the fundamental barriers that have left the talent of our communities sidelined. And now I get to come back and share with you the receipts. How are we doing on this vision? We started with a fundamental premise that when we invest in people and places, when we invest in fundamental infrastructure that has long been neglected, that we're going to see outsized returns for the entire economy, because we know the Treasury Department what you know, which is investing in our communities, investing in Latino communities is investing in America. And when we get our communities moving and growing and buying homes and growing and scaling and opening businesses, that it produces economic gains that benefit our entire country. So I want to start with sharing some of the early results because they're quite profound. We have had one of the most equitable recoveries on record. We are seeing Hispanic homeownership rates up by 2 percentage points from 2019 to 2023. And I know that this room and a lot of your colleagues had a lot to do with that. For those of you who don't know, when I was at Unidos, one of my jobs was to work with our housing counseling network. And so I know firsthand the work that many of our affiliates do to make sure that our families get a shot at that first rung on the ladder to build intergenerational wealth. We've seen median real wages for Latino workers have gone up 4% between 2019 and 2023, and Hispanic business ownership hit an all-time high of 9.8%. And for maybe the first time, we've started to see a decrease in the wealth gap. Hispanic family wealth increased by 47% from 2019 to 2022. I want to just pause on that for a moment, because I was here. I was in your seat when we went through the Great Recession. I was sitting with so many of you while we ran foreclosure rescue fairs in our neighborhoods across the country. And we know what an eviction and a foreclosure cliff looks like. Our families lost 60% of their wealth. And we didn't do that this time. We kept families in their homes, and we actually rebounded our economy, the earnings, the wages, and the wealth in our community. That's not to say that we're done. That's not to say that everybody is exactly where they need to be, but I want to draw this distinct picture between what we experienced in the last recession and what we're experiencing now. So as we go forward, because you know I'm not done, I'm never done, just like you guys are, five things, and I'm gonna roll through them pretty quickly. First, we're making sure that we've got a really good understanding of the impact of inequity in our economy. I know the next panel is going to get into all the headwinds that we're facing when it comes to our racial equity work, but I think one of the solutions is to start with the data and make sure that we understand the impact and we have a good path to the potential solutions. So we've been doing new research, for example, looking at the impact of things like the premium tax credit, which helps families purchase health insurance, the earned income tax credit, the child tax credit, the important role that plays for Latino families. Number two, we're strengthening capital delivery systems through our community development financial institutions, through our Latino-owned banks, Black-owned banks. Under our administration, we have literally put out billions of dollars to support CDFIs and MDIs. We put out $1.6 billion in Latino-owned and Latino-majority shareholder institutions with the expectation that across this portfolio, we're going to increase lending to the Latino community by $58 billion over the next decade. We also put out a record number of investments in Puerto Rico specifically, 70 grants totaling $226 million to the cooperativas in Puerto Rico. Protecting and growing assets, something fundamental to all the affiliates in this room that you work so hard on. Nothing more important right now than protecting the child tax credit. When we ran the advanced child tax credit, we saw a huge social experiment. When we put that out, when we made it refundable, when we put it in families' hands month over month, we saw Hispanic child poverty drop from 14.7% to 8.4%. This is why the president has continued to put it back in the budget every single year. We're looking at how we can promote economic mobility through the tax code, including how we modernize the ITIN acceptance process and make it easier for people who qualify for ITINs to get them. That is going to unlock access to credit. That is going to unlock ability to buy homes and just improve financial security overall for families. And finally, Another strategy is to make sure that this work is durable within the Treasury Department, that we are hiring in a way that reflects our community, that we are getting more proximate to our communities, that we're listening. I can't tell you how important this is. Some of the results that I talked about, they didn't happen by happenstance. And we know that because we know what happens when we programmed for the top of the market. We had massive foreclosures and our families lost out. But when we listened and got proximate to communities and we designed these solutions differently, we were able to see that when we program for the most vulnerable, we do better for everybody. We have to be able to incorporate that kind of ongoing value and methodology into the department. That's a big part of what I'm doing now, making sure that we've got that ongoing infrastructure. Treasury also has its own power of the purse. And so over the last 3 years, we've spent $45 million with Latino-owned businesses. I think we can do better. So we're gonna see how we do next year. But I think we've got a good start. These are just some of the things that I wanted to share with you. Because as I said, when I came first, I was like, here's what I hope that we're gonna do. And I need your help. And then you guys showed up and helped. And we've had really incredible results. I know that we can't continue to do this work without the ongoing collaboration of all the affiliates in this room. I'm so grateful for what you do in our communities every day. I'm grateful for the community intelligence, the feedback, the ways that you challenge our department. All of you should have my phone number, my email. I want to hear from you. I want to understand what's going on in communities. I want to understand what's not working and how do we make sure that it does in fact work for our Latino families. That's how we keep results like this going. That's how we continue to make the investments in our community that are fundamental to the economic success of our country. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you, Mrs. Bowdler. Now for this morning's panel, please welcome our moderator, Claudia Caballero, President and CEO, Centro Hispanic de East Tennessee. And our panelists, the Honorable Kiran Ahuja, Director of the U.S. Office of Personnel Management, Robert Espinosa, CEO, National Skills Coalition, and Dr. Jose Fierro, President Superintendent, Cerritos College.
Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Awesome.
Bienvenidos, buenos dias. Mi nombre es Claudia Caballero. I'm Honduran. I live in Knoxville, Tennessee, and I serve a wraparound organization there. I'm very happy to be with you today. We have a panel that is going to be discussing DEI, but we are really hoping that we can engage our audience in a way that we all think of DEI as our project. Oftentimes, when I hear DEI, I think it's somebody else's problem. Obviamente, I am DEI, right? Like, why should I be focusing on this personally? My organization is Latino, of course. But I really want to invite us all today to think about DEI in so many other levels of work that sometimes don't come to our minds because we can oftentimes be the token in a room, right? I laugh because when I come to our conference or any other conference, people are like, "Hay Latinos in Tennessee?" I'm like, there are so many Latinos in Tennessee. So really excited to have this panel with me today. We are talking about DEI in a lot of different areas, and it's become a little bit of a concern, right? When DEI is important, suddenly we are in the spotlight, right? How do we connect with the Latino community? How do we bring diverse voices to the table? But what happens when we don't have that situation, or when people are trying to shy away from it, as we've seen some things happening? I know in Tennessee, I hear departments and universities and organizations changing titles, dissolving positions. What does this look like for all of us, right? And how does DEI not only, how is it applied on a national level? How is it applied in our communities? But also how is it applied in our own organizations? We're really excited to have all the young people here today. I like saying that, I have mentors that are younger than me because you are the future of Latino population, of the Latino community, and you are setting up the narrative for us as we move forward. And I like to also say you are the strongest advocates of DEI in our own organizations, because I am challenged on a daily basis about our Latinidad and what that means and how we identify our indigenous identities, our Afro-Latino identities, our queer identities, our abilities. All of those get challenged by our young folks in our organization. So I want to thank you all for being here with us today and for participating in this conversation as well. I want to give an opportunity for each one of my panelists to talk a little bit about who they are and one thing that would surprise all of you about them, and I promised I would say one as well. So one of the things that might surprise folks is I am an avid Texas two-stepper. I can't really get that in Tennessee, but love dancing in Texas when I can get to an old dance hall. So that's my fun fact, and I'm going to let Kieran introduce herself. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. It's good to be here. So I'll just share a little bit about myself. I grew up in Georgia. I don't know if we have any Georgia folks here. And one person. Great. That's good. So I'm just going to talk to that one person today. And I don't have the Southern accent, or maybe sometimes I do when I'm when I mention Georgia, I'm thinking about Savannah, where I grew up. And that is because my parents are originally from India, from Bombay or Mumbai. So, you know, this crazy story of going from this big city and being dropped into these really rural parts of Georgia in the 1970s and 80s was just like mind-blowing for me. It was me as a brown immigrant trying to figure out what that looked like. And so early on, I realized like I wanted to be engaged in some of the really hard issues that I think all of you all are focused and working on. So I became a civil rights lawyer, and then started doing a lot of work in the Asian American Pacific Islander community, served in the Obama administration, and now in the Biden administration. All to say that I started as a community advocate, and I actually think we need community advocates in government, because you're doing a lot of internal advocacy. And so you need those tools. And when I was recruiting, when I ran the White House initiative on Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders, I only looked for community organizers to fill the seats of the people that I wanted in government. Okay, so the crazy thing about something that would surprise you about me is that I was a cheerleader in high school. Yeah, I wasn't on the debate team. And I didn't last very long as a cheerleader either, but that was the thing that I did.
Thank you. Thank you. That's an awesome fun fact.
Hi, everyone. Good morning. I'm Robert Espinoza. I'm the CEO of the National Skills Coalition. And I grew up in Pueblo, Colorado. Any Colorado folks? Thank you. I think there's a few.
A few more. Three more.
Yeah, it's great to hear. My mother was from Mexico, León, Guanajuato in particular. And my father was from a town called Alamosa, Colorado, which until the late 1800s was Mexico. And I grew up very politicized, especially in college, and I'll talk about that later. I spent the first 10 years of my career in the LGBTQ rights movement, and the last 10 years have been at the intersection of workforce aging and disability issues. And one surprising thing about me is that I was on one episode of a reality show.
As long as I was a cheerleader, right? That's
as long as you were a cheerleader. One episode of a reality show called Man Enough. It was hosted by Justin Baldoni of Jane the Virgin. It's still available, so you know, I'll leave it at that.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Jose Fierro. I'm the president superintendent at Cerritos College. Speaking of Southern accents, I think I have the most Southern accent here. I am from Colombia. I grew up in Bogota, Colombia. And I migrated to the United States in 1999. I did not speak a word of English when I got here, besides the thank you, you're welcome, and moving my head a lot, saying yes. Not in understanding when I was not understanding much of anything. The thing that you won't find about me, I had shared something else when we were preparing for this, but I suppose you will find that easily if you Google me. But there is one thing that you will not find about me. During the pandemic, I became a sim racer, and I continue to do that to this day as a hobby. So I do No idea what that is exactly. Why you won't find it online. So prior to the pandemic, I used to like to go to the track and drive cars, but in the pandemic, they closed everything. I decided to get and build a simulator, and I race online with people in what it seems like an actual cockpit. So my wife and my friends make tons of fun of me for doing that. But I find it distracting and relaxing in an odd way because it is very realistic and stressful when you're there. So that's the thing you won't find about me.
It's a stressful de-stressor. I love
that's
that.
Right.
Yeah. Thank you so much, folks. I'm excited to be here with you. We want to set some ground definitions and a little bit of as we start out with DEI. For those of you who don't know, it's diversity, equity, and inclusion. And we heard a new one in the back here is DEIA, accessibility. Is another letter to that acronym. And so I would love for Robert to start with us. I know you were talking a little bit about your story and how you became passionate about DEI. And I'd love for you to start with that and then a little bit of a definition for the, for the group.
Yeah, absolutely. Let me ask a question. How many people are active in their high schools or colleges, politically active in the room? Okay, a healthy group, that's great. So I actually became involved in DEI issues as an undergraduate student. In the late 1990s, I was an undergrad at the University of Colorado at Boulder. And it was the state flagship school. I see a hand over there. Go Buffs. This was a university that in the late 1990s was targeted by two major national conservative organizations as a test pilot to eliminate affirmative action. So they worked with our university board of directors, so to speak, and they eliminated both concrete goals and enforcement mechanisms from our state university system. And in those years, for those of you who remember this, it was the University of Colorado, it was UC Berkeley and the University of California system, and a few others that were really cutting edge on affirmative action, and the University of Colorado became the target. I was not politicized at that point. I was on track to get a degree in advertising. I visualized myself doing these fun creative campaigns and writing film reviews. It was a very different story. And yet I was a product of affirmative action. I was recruited by a journalism professor as a high school student who saw potential in me and helped me apply to the school and then get into it, fund all the funding support, et cetera. And I was horrified. I could not believe that a program that had such lofty goals to diversify the staff and the faculty and the administration in general was being eliminated by this, what seemed to be just really kind of out of touch ideas, right? That they weren't necessary, that they were reverse discrimination, and so on. So that forms a lot of my thinking about DEI and its importance. History repeats itself, and oftentimes racism mutates, right? And we're seeing that in the current attacks around DEI that have very similar threads to affirmative action, and some of the same spokespeople, I'll say, too, right? So for me, DEI means a few things. One is, it means that it's an intentional effort by organizations and businesses and governments to diversify their workforces, their recipients, all the people who interact with them, and to make sure that in the workforce context that they have opportunities to advance and to lead, right? The second is from a principal perspective that the people who are most impacted by the issues that are being described and shaped by either policy or industry reform are actually part of the solution. They're part of the conversation, right? And the third is that we remain aware of a broader cultural narrative, right? The political discourse that's threatening us, that's shaping the dialogue on what's discrimination and what's not. A DEI strategy says we're aware of it, but we step outside of it because diversity is good for business and it's good for people of color and others.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So with that definition, I'd love for Kieran and Jose to talk a little bit about, you know, how do we bring this to the ground, right? Like, we have a definition, it gets thrown around a lot. I know that when I think of DEI, especially, for example, in East Tennessee, I get asked a lot to be on boards, right? And it's like, as long as we have one Latino, maybe one black person, then we're good. Maybe one woman, then we're in. And so I talk a lot about the rule of three, right? If you really care about diversity, don't put me on alone. Find three people. So it's not one voice in one perspective. But tell us a little bit about, from government and from a university perspective or higher education perspective, how does DEI materialize for you?
Yes, I was going to say, I think all of you all are like part of organizations, right? Right?
Yes.
Everyone's like in an organization, either your staff or you're on the board or you're a volunteer or whatever you do in your day job. And I think from my perspective, I shared a little bit with you about kind of my, I guess my upbringing and my orientation to this work. But right now, I lead the Office of Personnel Management for the federal government. So we're the largest employer in the country, 2.2 million people. So as from our perspective, we need to be the model employer for the rest of the country, and that is definitely when it comes to DEI, and we add the A, which is accessibility. So we take a very targeted approach, actually, to bringing in individuals with disabilities into the federal government, so the A is really important. So I take this from a couple of different perspectives. One is that I think exactly what we already heard, which is, like, we cannot function as a government without having diversity of voices and experiences as a part of the federal government. We can't administer grant programs, we can't think about what are going to be the right policies unless people with the lived experiences are actually a part of our organization. So diversity is the, you know, functional business case. And I think a part of how you talk about this and how you think about it is you can call it DEI or you can just call it, this is good for business. This is good for our organizations. And I think it's about depoliticizing in a lot of ways, a lot of the rhetoric that's out there. Listen, I've been on the Hill during my confirmation hearing, during other hearings where I get called out about my commitment to DEIA, to equity. And you know, frankly, I think all we have to do is remind folks about that every single company around is thinking about like the importance of having individuals who represent the diversity of this country. And it doesn't just have to be race and ethnicity, right? It is where we grew up, or the languages that you speak, or even your political orientation. So I think that that's really important. I would say also another piece of this is that we think about the DEI work in a very broad way. So for example, we qualify DEI as when we're opening the doors to the federal government for the formerly incarcerated. That is our DEI work. When we're now requiring agencies to pay interns, why this is like a novel thing, but government has like live off of unpaid internship labor for a long time, and we know that that's not accessible for a lot of folks. So it's really like taking a much closer look and saying this is not just diversity trainings, this is fundamentally every single part of your organization. And how I kind of put a big umbrella to this, frankly, is it's about good leadership. It's about building an inclusive work culture and environment. And if you start framing it that way, almost everything you do functionally is tied to these principles around DEIA.
Absolutely. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. It reminds me a lot of, you know, do you surround, as a good leader, do you want to surround yourself with people that agree with you or have your same perspective? Mm-hmm. Or do you want to be surrounded by people that will challenge you to
yes.
have a broader perspective?
Yeah. Yeah.
And also from an economic standpoint,
yeah.
companies mm-hmm. are more profitable if they are more diverse
yes.
in their leadership.
Yeah.
So, Jose, tell us a little bit about higher education. It's something we're seeing a lot of. I know in Tennessee, there are a lot of changes in titles. Universities are afraid mm-hmm. of losing funds. Students are feeling unseen or pushed into the background. So tell us a little more about how you are managing this.
Well, I think we're falling within a trap, separating the DEIA depending on your setting and
yeah.
your context. Separating the DEIA depending on your ethnicity, separating the DEIA based on your identity. It is all connected. And we cannot continue to fall within the trap of separation, because as we do that, it's way easier to stop a movement that is actually unstoppable. With all these changes and regulations, I feel that the intention is to try to stop and pretend that diversity is not here, but that is impossible. It's like trying to cover the sun with your tongue. Just look around you and tell me whether or not diversity is going away. It is not. What we need to do is actually stop talking and moving into implementation. So, for instance, there is a lot of conversation of diversity training, diversity hiring, meeting specific target goals of hiring people of this group or that group. And yes, that is a step, but in reality, in my opinion, that is perhaps the low-hanging fruit. And low-hanging fruit produces small results. We need to go for the high-hanging fruit, for the fruit that is high to reach. And what I mean by that is by establishing a baseline in which we educate and empower the newer generations to create an environment that fits our current needs. What do I mean by that? I mean that we cannot continue to allow people of color, particularly Latinos and Latinas, to not graduate out of college and out of associate degrees and baccalaureate degrees. Why? Because that decreases your social and economic mobility, that decreases your income capacity, and if you do not have income capacity, you're unable to change your current environment, without mentioning that you're unable to access higher benefits, retiring, develop a line in your family that is a college-going family. So essentially, in my opinion, everything begins with education and helping our young people to graduate and empower them to change the rules. And last comment I make on this is learning how to vote. It is not sufficient to have in our campuses vote drives and registration drives to empower our young generation to vote. We need to teach them how to do so. And we do that by teaching them how to research the voting records of the people that we're going to elect. If they do not vote in our best interest, why should we vote for them? If they do not uphold the same type of ethic and moral standards that we do, why should we vote for them? And what is worse, why are we surprised when they change the rules to something that isn't to our advantage? And even worse, we vote them in office again. Mm-hmm. So it's not enough to vote. We need to learn how to vote on what is our best interest.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I think as we think about, you know, what this looks like in government and also in higher education, I'm thinking about every person in the room today. And I'm thinking about, you know, what our role is in this time. And we think about, I've seen it on the boards I serve, in the conversations I've been locally. What does it look like for people in organizations like ours to advocate for the importance of DEI in our communities? We often are the voice of the Latino community, right? It's a big responsibility, not only an honor, but we are carrying the voice of many people. What does it look like? I know when I think about this in my community, I tell people all the time, there's no one single story of the Latino. We know that. We know there isn't a single story. And how do we express that as we move forward in our DEI? So again, this is the frustration I'll get. You know, it's like, as one Latina from, one white presenting Latina from Honduras, mm-hmm. I cannot possibly bring to the table everything you need in terms of the vision or the perception of our Latino community. So everyone here has their own story, their own identity. What they bring is talent. What can we do in our spaces of influence? And that might not be a board, and it might not be, what are the circles that we're in, right? Our friend circles or our university circles. What can we do? And this is a question for any of you. Mm-hmm. What is our role? What is our responsibility in DEI as it moves forward?
Sure, I'll start with that. It's a big one, and I think my immediate reaction is that it needs to be intentional, it needs to be forceful, and it needs to be careful. And so what I'll say is that, you know, I work at the National Skills Coalition. We are an organization that's been around since 2000. We focus on advancing policy at the federal and state level that supports workers, specifically in the areas of skills training and career pathways, though much more. And we work in a bipartisan way. So we work closely with Democrats and Republicans, and we work with coalitions in 20 states, and lots of federal leaders who are invested in this workforce. And so our mandate, our positioning as an organization is to be bipartisan, to bring people together in an incredibly divisive political climate, to think about issues that we can actually move forward when so many issues just don't make it past a certain line, right? So as a new CEO, I've been in this role for 2 months, and as somebody who's devoted my entire life to racial justice, it does raise the question of how to do that, right? So a few thoughts that come to mind. I mean, one is that it's important that we understand kind of what is the role of our entities, whether we're a university, a government, a college, I mean, an organization, et cetera. Like, what is our unique value add to the sectors in that we're operating in, and what is the most strategic way to move this issue forward? So for us, really linking the issue of diversity, equity, inclusion, and access to workforce and workforce training by showing stories and telling systemic stories of why Latino and Latina people and other communities of color have had very different employment trajectories, have faced discrimination in their lives, on the jobs, et cetera. Like, being able to tell that story in a way that's human, that's emotional, that's rational, and that kind of moves up beyond the kind of the contentious hysteria of certain political discussions, right? That's, in my opinion, the only way that we'll be able to continue working in a bipartisan way. It might also mean that we might lose some people, right? It might mean that there might be certain, you know, policymakers or certain funders who aren't on board with that. And the question becomes, what does courage look like in this moment, and how do we make sure that we're moving people forward? The third thing that I'll say finally is that the narrative on DEI and on equity and justice in general merits even more understanding about how do you frame it and message it in today's discourse. I sit on the board of an organization called Frameworks Institute, and we're a nonprofit that studies deeply held public mindsets on a whole range of issues, including culture issues, workforce issues, care issues, et cetera, to understand how are people currently thinking about these issues, and then how do advocates frame and message in a way that doesn't lose people, right? It's probably not talking about isms in a public way, because there's a lot of research showing that people turn off and actually don't understand the word, any word that ends in ism, right? But there are ways to preserve the authenticity of those arguments in ways that use kind of broader descriptions that help people move forward. And I think that's something that a lot of us can do better. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Go ahead.
No. I want to ask Jose a question around how do you see young people advocating for DEI in your institution? So you have 23,000 students, wow. And what percentage are Latino?
Yeah, about 23,000, and 68-69% of our students are Latino, Latina, and only 6% of the campus population is identified as white. So we are a majority-minority serving institution. Mm-hmm. I think what our students are asking is, how are we contributing to a better economic future for them? Gone are the days in which the students blindly follow what we tell them to follow. They're asking questions as to, are they jobs when I complete this degree? What type of services can you provide that will help me integrate in this community? Am I going to be welcome here? So services around inclusivity, relationship building, and whether or not we can offer a path for social mobility. Now, there is a limit to that, which is interesting to find, that is not all about money. Mm-hmm. This job could pay $150,000, but if I do not feel connected to it, mm-hmm. or younger students are less likely to choose that career path versus one that they feel connected, seen, and included. I think we need to be very mindful of those situations as we work with our students in order to really shape the institutions to be student ready rather than hoping that the institutions are, the students are ready for us. Mm-hmm. Two, we need to teach them how to learn and disseminate facts about Latinos. Mm-hmm. For instance, it is false that Latinos were lazy and did not work during the pandemic. They're the number one ethnic group employed during that time, the fastest growing income during the 2 years of the pandemic, over 7.6% the Latino income grew. The Latino GDP, $3.2 trillion, the fifth largest economy, and only second to the growth of the Chinese economy. So we need to teach our students what is the truth about Latinos versus what is the narrative that we see out there so they can help disseminate that information and build the courage that takes to make the changes that we want to see moving forward.
Thank you. Thank you. Kieran, I want to ask you, how can we help further the efforts that are being implemented in your department, and how can we help in a community to lift up the DEI work and oftentimes in places that are not necessarily welcoming to DEI work? Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, I love when you said about how kind of flip the script, which is like, how ready is your institution for these individuals versus like how ready are they to come in? That's very powerful. I think that's a very positive reframing. And I think we think the same thing in the federal government. Granted, we're a very, very large institution, but I think one thing that we have that works in our favor is that if we think about the younger generation, they very much want to feel like they are a part of an organization that cares about its mission and what it's trying to achieve as far as a positive impact on this world. And I think we try to use that as a big draw, not only in what I talked about earlier, which is like, what is the kind of environment that we're trying to create? We're trying to promote kind of a very inclusive and positive work culture that is supported by DEIA, but also that we know, I often say in federal government, we win on mission in the sense that you can literally think about any job and that exists within the federal government. I think it's a big part when we think about the economy, which I loved how you framed it, which is, you know, we institutionally as a federal government historically have been the pathway to the middle class for communities of color. It was true for the African American community, it's been true for so many other communities of color. And also the fact is that there's a federal job in every single county in this country, and 80% of our jobs are outside Washington, D.C. So this idea of what it means to like set yourself up for success, that you see yourself as a part of these civil institutions. I do think it's important, even though this is not exactly your question, I do think there is a huge effort politically to diminish the value of civic and civil institutions. And the only way that we prop those up and we support them is by either we decide to take a role within them or we understand the value of these government institutions. And if anyone tells you that they are not affected by the government, it's a big fat lie. Whether it's a local, state, or even federal government, we permeate every single part of everyone's lives. If you claim that you don't care about these government institutions, but you get all these benefits, whether it's Medicare or other things, this is because of the people who are a part of the federal government or any other government. That is why we need that level of diversity in these institutions. So I'm gonna have a bias. I want all of you to come and try, you know, an opportunity in the federal government. But if not, to your question, I do think these type of opportunities. You were here in Washington, D.C. You were building the skills and making connections and getting connected and getting a better understanding of the kinds of policies from various, you know, agencies or the different type of issues that you want to work on, whether it's housing or economic development or healthcare, or it could be whatever your immigration, whatever issue you care about. The idea is that, and what I think is so powerful about organizations like this, is that you're relentless and you continue to push us in a way that we're holding ourselves accountable to what you care about as a community. And I think that is fundamentally the give and take that has to happen from, you know, the exchange that we have with the American public as a government institution. There is a very clear message that, one party believes that we are accountable to what our communities need. And then there's another that suggests that we just need to continue to dismantle every single positive function within the federal government or even government institutions across the country. So I do think, you know, we can talk about this from, you know, DEIA perspective and the kind of environments that we need to, like, basically not be the only Latina speaking about these issues. And it can happen whether you're on a board or in a family conversation, or we can take it to a higher level that we're talking about, which is like the education that we need to do in our community, or fundamentally the very bedrock of democracy, which is our government institutions. So not only preserving them, but being a part of them and playing a role. So not only just voting to participate, I would say part of my civic duty of going from a community leader is to serve in government and understand the value of that experience as well.
Thank you. Yeah. So she's inviting everyone to apply for a position. I want to give a round of applause to our panelists, and we're going to open up for questions. But thank you for sharing. I want to give the opportunity for folks to ask questions while we have a few minutes. So is anyone ready for a question? Oh, thank you.
Good morning, my name is Daniela Puente, and I'm currently a CHCI Health Postgraduate Fellow, but prior to this, I worked in DEIA at Syracuse University with their health center, and a problem that I noticed recurring was there was a bit of a disconnect between what administrators and staff at the university saw as the needs of underrepresented communities and what students like myself and other students communicated were their needs. How do you recommend we bridge the divide between meeting the needs and what, you know, staff are perceiving as the needs of students?
That's for you.
I think this is the perfect example of why equity, diversity, inclusion, and access is so important in higher education. Because in order to be able to understand issues of the communities that we serve, we need to hire leaders who are from the community or had connections to the community. We should not be ashamed to seek leaders of color when you are serving communities of color, and that will minimize the disconnect that we see in these situations.
Thank you. We've got some folks with questions back here.
Hi, my name is Denise. I am a student at the University of Northern Colorado. And so we are actually transitioning into becoming an HSI at my university, which is exciting. But at the same time, how could we as students, Latino advocates at our universities, apply pressure to like the sorry, I'm a little nervous. How could we apply pressure at our institutions to make sure that when we are transitioning into an HSI, that we have better benefits for our students and that they're fully engaged and wanting to make differences in the institution that positively affect our Latino students?
Thank you so much. I think this is a really great question because, you know, when we think of the United States as a whole, sometimes I think a young person could feel very lost in how their voice could be heard or how their opinion could make a difference. So I think the microcosm of a smaller institution is really the place where, as you said, Robert, you know, that's the first inspiration because you can feel, you can see the effects of your work in a very closed environment in a way. Any of you really, but what is your experience?
I was gonna say from the perspective of like the federal government and then I know kind of being an institution. So a part of becoming an HSI or MSI is that you start to qualify for federal money and grants. So I would say at the outset, knowing that your institution is moving in that direction, they ultimately want to apply for those monies. And so ensuring when they're writing that grant that they're putting in the activities that you all care about and writing that into the actual grant application that gets approved. So once you're on the hook with the money, that means the institution has to deliver.
I think this is a really great point. When we think about this from a business background, right? So thinking about the work that you're doing, not only because it is the best for the students, but how is it economically impacting the institution? And that's the power you have, right? So I would recommend as well in this, don't just ask to add some of the activities. If there's no budget for it, they don't really care about it. So make sure budget gets tied in so that you have the flexibility to add activities, events, engagement in different ways. That's a great leverage point. Mm-hmm. If they want access to those funds, they need you. And so I think it's really a lot about changing the power dynamic in that. You know, it's not you begging for something or asking for something. It's really advocating and saying, we're already here, we're here to help you, and this is what we need to be able to do that. And I know Jose is.
Yeah, sadly, the only requirement to qualify to become an HSI is to serve 25% of the students, a Latino or Latinas. That's it. That gives the university access to be labeled as an HSI with no accountability moving forward. Mm. So I think it's very important for you as Latino students to partner with the student government and truly develop an agenda that is focused not on being labeled as an HSI, but a university that graduates Latino and Latina students at a higher rate. Mm-hmm. Oftentimes, universities and colleges look at the nomination of HSI for access to extra funding, but not in order to serve the Latino students properly. Mm-hmm. But since you are having those conversations, I strongly encourage you to partner with the student government and really set meetings to meet with the president of the university and with the provost or vice president of academic affairs to really ask for data of the performance, specifically of Latino students, and what type of initiatives are being built in order to increase graduation rates. It's not enough to celebrate Hispanic History Month, to do Taco Tuesday, and to say we love all. If you do not graduate, they are not helping you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much. As we move forward, thinking about DEI not only as an outer initiative, but also in our own organizations, how we're growing our own communities and how we're helping people in upward mobility in our own institutions. I want to give another round of applause to our panelists, and I thank you all so much.